Pro Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.
Everyone, and welcome to Pro Life Berks. We're recording this program again a little early, so it won't be live and won't be any opportunity for calling questions, but we're still on the COVID restrictions. So rather than only have one guest, we wanted to have this couple on together. So this evening, we're going to be having Megan and Paul Nicotra. They are new members of our board. However, they've been pro-life for quite a while. And they're going to, our topic is going to be what it means to be pro-life. You know, we talk about it all the time. We've been talking about it for 22 years on this program. But we want to bring everybody up to date. You know, we know there's new people watching this program. So, but before we get into all the nitty gritty, why don't you both tell us a little bit about yourself, where you're from, how you met? You'll get a little personal touch.
Sure, absolutely. You know, first, we wanted to thank you for our nomination to the Pro-Life Berks board. You know, like you said, we've been involved in this for a little while, and our interest has been kind of growing over, you know, the last several years. You know, we keep trying to up our game, and I think we really both feel like being part of the board is kind of our calling. I mean, it's something that's probably...
Let me tell you, we're going to have things for you to do, so
okay.
Don't worry about nothing to do. So where are you guys from and how did you meet?
We've only been married for 3 years. So
right. I knew that.
Okay. I grew up in Berks County. I've been here most of my life. I moved here at the end of my first grade year. So I've been in Warnersville, Robesonia, that kind of area for almost my entire life. Paul comes from a little bit further away.
Yeah, I'm born and raised in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Lived there for the first 20 plus years of my life.
Wow.
I've been living in Wernersville now for about 20 years.
What made you move east with a job?
My job, I'm an engineer and I started working for Bayer Aspirin in Myerstown.
Oh, okay.
So that brought me out to this side of the state. Then I since took a job in Delaware and I have a 75 mile commute each way.
Oh, my word.
I listen to a lot of audio books.
A lot of tapes. You're well informed, I'm sure.
You know, and while picking up audio books, I met Megan at the library. She's the librarian.
Is that right? Oh, how sweet.
Yep.
Oh, that's very romantic. We should have had you on for February for Valentine's Day. So did you hit it off right away?
We were friends for a long time.
Yeah, we were friends for a very long time. Yeah. We have children, you know, very close in age. Megan has three boys. I have four girls.
Oh my goodness! Big
so we had children
family.
in the same grades and so forth. Uh-huh. And that's, you know, how we began talking to each other about school events and things like that.
Yeah. Well, how did you get into pro-life? Get your interest in pro-life work?
Well,
is there one particular issue or church or what?
You know, going back, you know, being born in Pittsburgh, I was raised a cradle Catholic. I was an altar boy. My brothers were altar boys. You know, it's like everybody was an altar boy that went to school. That's just the way it was in the 1970s.
Yeah.
But, you know, and I asked my mother recently, like, you know, was there any conversation about, you know, pro-life or pro-abortion in the 1970s? And she said, there's never really much talk about it because everybody knew it was wrong, you know, and no one would do that. And, you know, probably in the small towns that we lived in, that was the case, but not, you know, maybe not so much on the national level. So, you know, really, I hadn't heard about much for the pro-life movement, you know, maybe until I got to high school. I remember being in high school and it was a Catholic high school. That there was never really any strong conversations in religion class about pro-life. I don't remember ever hearing anything about pro-life.
That's unbelievable. Oh my gosh.
You know, and the one memory that I do have is when it came to like speech and debate class in high school, nobody was allowed to pick abortion for speech and debate. You know, it was said that that was too common a topic. Everybody would pick it, you know, and therefore nobody picked it. So there was no dialogue in a Catholic school debating the, you know, the rights and wrongs of.
Wow. Well, they put the clamps on that.
Yeah.
I grew up Protestant, and actually there was quite a bit of talk about abortion. And when Roe v. Wade was passed, there were many Protestant activists that I didn't get involved because my husband was in the military and we weren't settled. But that, of all places, you would think in church have been the strongest. What a shame.
Yeah. How about you, Megan? So,
Growing up, my family, you know, went to church every Sunday. I was raised Lutheran. My family was Lutheran. So we were very involved in church, did all the, you know, social activities. Everybody was in choirs and youth groups and things like that. But honestly, I don't ever recall, you know, abortion, you know, being discussed. It really wasn't a big deal. Were
you in a conservative Lutheran church, would you say, or not?
How conservative are the mainline?
I know, but some seem to be a little better than others.
I wouldn't say it was terribly conservative, no.
Uh-huh.
Because when, as I became an adult, you know, I was starting to question things at that church, and the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod seemed to take a lot stronger stance on things. And I was like, well, you know, why don't we talk about these things? Things even like women's ordination and homosexuality and stuff that, you know, everything seemed to be okay where I was. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't particularly comfortable with that. But at that point, I would say I had a stronger identity as a conservative, a Republican. I was, you know, interested in politics, even as a young, you know, a young girl. I remember skipping a sleepover with friends one time because the Republican National Convention was on and I knew that I wanted to watch it and that wouldn't be something.
Oh, that's good. Well, so how did you go from just general information about abortion to getting involved?
I was always kind of a nerd.
He doesn't say my wife's a nerd.
Uh-huh. Yeah, what did you say? I'm sorry, I think I cut out a minute. Pardon me?
No.
Go ahead.
I was going to say that it didn't really happen until I came to the Catholic Church. And when I became a Catholic and things started to make sense, and I realized that beliefs were one thing, but you also had to take some action.
And how long ago was that?
I went through the RCIA program at St. Ignatius in 2011 and came into the church spring of 2012. So
wonderful.
And it was a wonderful program. I learned so much. And, you know, all of a sudden I was able to make connections between faith and my life. Whereas, you know, growing up, it was what we did on Sundays, but it didn't really have any effect on how I lived my life the rest of the week. Right. I certainly wasn't, you know, trying to be a holy person. And, you know, I didn't know anything about the spiritual and corporal works of mercy. You know, mm-hmm. I didn't really know I was supposed to be doing things as a Christian. So as I learned more and more about my Catholic faith as time went on, I knew that, you know, the pro-life movement was really spoke to me, and it was something that I felt that I could do. You know, hey, I can go stand, you know, outside an abortion clinic and pray a rosary, even though I'm a very private and shy person, you know, and it's terribly difficult for me.
Well, you're very brave. God bless you. There aren't that many people that can do it. I mean, let's be honest. There's a lot, especially when at the other location in the city, it was a very dangerous neighborhood. This is at least a little better neighborhood, but people do not. I'll tell you something. When my daughter lived here in Berks County, she would not drive up Franklin Street on a Tuesday because she was so embarrassed that her mother was on the corner. So I know exactly how you feel. She's still that way. She's very pro-life and she helps out crisis pregnancy centers, but she's not going to hold a sign or come out and fight. It's just not going to happen.
Yeah. Yep. And that's okay. You know, we need people doing all sorts of things.
Exactly. Exactly. So how about you?
I would say the big turning point that I can remember specifically was around the 2016 election. You know, so we had Donald Trump going up against Hillary, you know, and I had family members and friends that just didn't like Donald Trump, and they were probably going to be voting for Hillary. And I'm like, okay, you know, you got to put your personality differences aside. You know, if you're that much on the fence, you need to pick the candidate that is supporting life. You know,
right?
You do not have an option as a Catholic to pick a pro-death candidate. You know, don't split hairs about personalities or the environment or whatever. You know, the real thing that matters, you know, it matters to us and matters to God is protecting lives, you know, especially innocent lives. You know, so that was my probably my biggest recollection where I started really talking to people and voicing my opinion about pro-life.
Did you get any kickback from your families when you moved into this more active role?
Definitely got some. Yeah. I use, you know.
How are they now? Have you won anybody over?
Not yet.
We're working on it.
I know how you feel.
Family's the hardest, you know, because you.
Yeah, right. That's exactly right.
You can't push people away because that doesn't solve anything.
Right.
But, you know, you want to also not sit back and say, well, there's nothing I can do. You know, you gotta keep laying the seeds. And
right, and they have to come around themselves. Yeah. Like you say, can't blame the seeds, keep bringing up the issue, even if it's just little, you know, tidbits here and there.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's so. Yep. So President Trump was that really got you going.
Yeah, that was about the time. I'm trying to get people to not get vote more for active. Hillary.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And what did you have a particular issue that kind of got you revved up? I mean, within the abortion issue.
I would say, you know, so right around the time of the election too, I'm also a member of the Knights of Columbus at St.
Oh, good.
Wales.
Right.
And I'm an officer. My position is lecturer. So they asked me once a month to give a talk on whatever topic that I would like, which is kind of fun. I can decide whatever I want to talk to the whole group about on any given month.
For 2 minutes.
Hey, but that's all you can say a lot in 2 minutes.
So sometimes
our program used to only be 30 minutes. And honestly, we could fill that 30 minutes in so much information. It was amazing. Yeah. But good.
I was going to say, so at the time of that election, I ended up giving a 20-minute presentation on, you know, the moral obligations of voting. And I kind of walked them through a lot of the, you know, fine details. And yeah, something to your point, something that shocked me and struck me and a lot of people in the room also that day was that, you know, I found the research that 50% of Catholics are voting pro-death. I was like, how is this possible? How can you go to church every Sunday?
And it's been that way for, you know, the last years, many years.
Yeah.
I mean, it's improved slightly, but not nearly what it should be. I know it. I don't understand it.
Yeah.
To me, you know, coming into the church and knowing the graces you have in the Catholic Church that you don't have as a Protestant, I mean, you would think the Catholics would be strong, strong, strong. And you don't always see that. You see some. I know you two go to the Latin Mass. I don't know if you saw that survey that Bob Wirt sent around, but he showed the difference between Catholics who went to the Novus Ordo Mass and those that went to the traditional Latin Mass and how much stronger the Latin Mass people were on their issues, mass attendance and how pro-life they were and voting pro-life. In fact, I'm gonna put it in the next newsletter. I thought it was fascinating.
And because they're being taught from the pulpit on a daily or weekly basis, that they're being taught the faith, which we're lacking in the Novus Ordo parishes. Now,
yeah,
we have heard some homilies recently in the last, 6 months or so that did address abortion, in the Novus Ordo Mass, which was wonderful. And I was really glad to see.
St. Ignatius is pretty, they're pretty good about speaking up about pro-life. That they are.
Yeah.
So you were fortunate that you got into that church.
Yeah.
But, it's hard to find that zeal.
Yeah. During the, back during the 2016 election, we had a visiting priest at St. Francis de Sales. And as a part of his homily right before the election, he said, there's different deciding factors with elections, as they come up. Sometimes it's pro-life and sometimes it's the environment. And my wife and I were like, what did we just hear? How can you compare pro-life to the environment and having a priest, say that was just a
right. That's the crux of the problem, I think. They haven't been trained properly. For some priests, I think some are not courageous. They don't want to rock the boat or offend anyone, so they stay neutral, and it hurts everyone.
It does.
So right now, what issue or issues are you looking at the most or concerned about the most?
Well, I think, what everybody's talking about right now is the vaccines, the COVID vaccines, vaccines in general, using, either this fetal stem cells for their development or using them in their testing. And Bishop Athanasius Schneider from Kazakhstan is so strong on this issue.
Oh, he is.
And LifeSite did a wonderful, it was a full day conference back in February, just addressing all these different issues around COVID and vaccines and all sorts of things. And, he actually called for a new pro-life movement, a new element to the pro-life movement that would just, address the use of fetal stem cells in vaccines. Of course we know
in any kind of products. There's been talk, at least there's been talk over the last 20 years, but there really hasn't been, that I'm aware of, that they've really, that the Conference of Bishops has taken a strong stand. That I'm not sure of.
Yeah, no, but, they haven't.
I was gonna bring that list and I forgot. I was going to hold it up. We put a list in last month's newsletter, I think it was in last month's, or was it January, of all the companies that make the stem cells, that make the COVID vaccines, and every single one of them either used them in production or used them for testing. There was not one that was.
And that's
a concern because, the USCCB now is saying it's okay to take it if you don't have another choice, but.
Right. And so what happens when people refuse to take it for religious reasons and then the authorities come back and say, look, your church says you can take it.
Exactly. Exactly. There's no protection.
Nothing to stand on.
Yeah. Your Pope took it,
Yeah.
Yeah. Unbelievable. No, I think that's one of the things when it comes to vaccines and fetal stem cells and all that. I was just horrified by the hidden camera footage of an abortion representative and somebody buying the abortion clinic. It's like it really has shown that people have made an industry out of killing babies.
Oh my gosh, huge.
And they sit around and they're having coffee and laughing about how many baby parts I can get you. And I was just like, what is this, a world that we live in? Is this?
I know. It's beyond comprehension. I never in a million years thought that I would see this day. Never. Yeah. There's always been evil and I've been in the healthcare industry, my whole adult life. And it's just shocking. And I hate to say it. I really hate to say this, but some of the girls I went to school with that, are nurses, retired now, thank goodness, but they go along with all this. And we had the strong training in the early 60s before everything hit. So people have caved. There's just no question about it. But so you're not taking COVID. You're not taking the shot, are you?
No.
Not either.
And we're trying to, you know, we're trying to educate, you know, family members and friends, and especially if people, you know, ask us, what do you think about the vaccine, you know? And it just doesn't make any sense to take it when they say that, you know, it doesn't guarantee you won't get it. It doesn't guarantee you won't pass it along. It doesn't mean you can stop social distancing. It doesn't mean you can stop wearing a mask. Well, why would we take it?
And there's no guarantee there's no side effects, because those are popping up. Some people are dropping over, you know, the next day. And so what, there is a risk factor that has to be considered, and you don't hear that.
And when the recovery rate is in the high 90s for, you know, COVID to begin with, you know, what is the
point? Why would you do it? Yeah.
Why would you take the risk? I see pregnant women taking it and then losing their babies.
Right.
You know, they say they're doing it to protect their baby, but, you know, I don't know where they get their information, you know, the mainstream media, I suppose.
So how can we get the word out more than we're doing? I don't know. We have it on, we mentioned it on our program, we mentioned it in our newsletter, but I don't think we're really, really influencing the mainstream Christians, the Catholics and Protestants. I don't know what I mean, there's a few strong voices out there, but there's not enough, clearly. Do you have any thoughts on?
I really like the new billboards. You know, I wish people.
Oh, maybe we should do a COVID billboard.
The two new billboards that we have out there. I mean, I was thinking about just pro-life in general. I mean, we talk to people all the time about the vaccine, and people are just afraid. They've been just, you know, brainwashed over the last year of how deadly this disease is. And, it's like, really, did you take a step back? Do you know what the survival rate is? You know, it's not an emergency. You know, we're trying to, you know, push our friends and family about not taking the vaccine. And it's even, we've, you know, heard comments that says, I didn't have an abortion, so it's okay that I should get the vaccine. It wasn't me that had an abortion. And that baby's life wouldn't have been wasted if somebody gets the vaccine. And I'm like, wow, that sounds like something that might have been said by the Nazis. You know, it's okay to do this to people and hurt people, because in the end, the end justifies the means, when it's just, it's crazy that, you know, everybody knows how bad Nazi Germany was and all the things they did, but look what we're doing now. It's
right.
It's,
people just went along then and they're just going along now, and it's a problem. Well, we'll have to consider billboards. We can't do any at Planned Parenthood, but maybe we can do them someplace else.
It's hard.
We've had them on off and on over the years. We've done them different, so we know where the busy streets are.
Right. It's hard when the places that you normally turn to, like Facebook and Twitter, and even Parler, where people tried to go to Parler to, you know, get out from all the restrictions and the
censorship
closing censorship. Down of the discussion. When big tech is just able to shut you down, you know, we are kind of left out in the cold. I think as conservatives and Christians, we need to maybe be building our own infrastructure. And I think Michael Matt at The Remnant is doing a great job of that, doing a video platform where, you know, he's got all his stuff on his own site now. So he's not worried about, you know, YouTube's rules, you know, shutting him down, taking him off, whatever. So he's, you know,
I'll have to look. I haven't looked on his website for a while. There's just so much to, you know, read and keep up with, but he's very good.
It's overwhelming. That's a good
thing. You know, what he's saying is truthful. He's not going to exaggerate or anything.
Right.
But, what's the next issue that you think is so direly important at this point in time? Do you have another? What do you think? We have abortion. I mean, that's the big one. And we have COVID, which is very big right now because of the consequences that's coming out of it. but what would you say, what would be like your third most important issue in your mind?
Yeah, you want me to start?
Sure.
I was going to say, so we attended a Humane Vitae conference in Philadelphia back in 2018.
Uh-huh.
You know, and I really didn't know anything about what that was, you know. Uh-huh. So I learned it's, you know, a paper that Pope John the Sixth wrote.
Is
that
Paul
right?
Paul the Sixth? Okay.
Paul
the
Sixth.
But you know, they really start with how the culture has changed, how women should be more like men, you know, and women's rights, and they should be out in the workforce. And you know, and then all of a sudden, babies become a problem because it's hard to, you know, to be a woman trying to live the man's life and to be pregnant. Mm-hmm. And now all of a sudden, babies are a problem, you know, and contraceptive, you know, contraception boomed, you know, and everybody thinks, you know, when there's, you know, 50 or there's 70 million women on birth control these days, and you know, and that turns out to be a fundamental problem. Mm-hmm. You know, and like I said, then pregnant women, it becomes a problem. And 90% of people that are, you know, on birth control are using it improperly. And, you know, and so you don't have a 99% success rate, you've got a 90%. So right. Now you've got a ton of unwanted pregnancies, you know, and it kind of all starts with, you know, going back to, you know, it's like women's rights, you know.
It goes back to the contraceptive mentality when contraception right. became the norm and accepted. You know, his position in Humanae Vitae was very unpopular because everyone was expecting at that time the Catholic Church to approve contraception. And he warned about the things that the consequences that we are actually living today.
And that was back in the 60s.
That was back in the
60s. More or less early 60s, I guess. Yeah, that's huge. That has always been probably my second most urgent issue. You know, abortion, of course, you know, we never want to see anyone killed. But I think my second one would be birth control because of the tremendous damage it has done to our society and to teenagers. Yeah. And this is what Planned Parenthood has just been expert at, and that is to get the kids in, get them sexually active, get them on birth control. They know they're going to make mistakes. You know, they're going to get pregnant. They're going to need an abortion. And so they've created their own business, their own niche.
One-stop shop.
And it's, you know, for kids, it's devastating. Yeah. Now, I would say that in the last few years, there at least is more discussion about birth control and abstinence with teenagers. But I can remember back when we started Pro Life Berks back in 1998, it was pretty free, the information about if you wanted to go on birth control, oh, well, just go. There was no wall stopping it, I hate to say it. Mm-hmm. And we actually spoke up about it. We actually boycotted some organizations that were Catholic because they were sending girls to Planned Parenthood as referrals.
Oh boy.
Crazy. Well, did we ever get in trouble? Oh my gosh. Took years to get.
Well, then you know you're doing something right.
So, oh my goodness. That was, you'd have thought, you know, we attacked the Pope or something. it was horrible. And from every level of the church, I mean, it was not, I mean, they understood what we were trying to do and they understood what was going on, but you couldn't talk about it because God forbid you might hurt fundraising or something, some such thing, which didn't make any sense.
Yeah.
So this is an issue. Yeah. This is one you can feel free to take on and figure out a way that we can get the word out better, because we've talked about it on this program many times. We've had doctors, we've had guests, we've had priests or two. And I think things have improved a little bit, but not in the general public. No, general public doesn't get it.
I mean, you know, it starts with the doctors. I was shocked to find, you know, that like my teenage daughter, who, you know, was on birth control, and, you know, and I told her she needed to get off that because of the dangers. You know, she was on it because she was having some difficulties, and it was supposed to help some of her difficulties. But, you know, when she goes and tells a doctor that she doesn't want to be on it, they're like shocked. How can you not want to be on birth control?
Right. You know? Especially if they're giving it for acne.
Yeah.
A lot of times, and then it becomes a status symbol with the teens that, oh, I'm on birth control. Like, you know,
it's a very big,
that's the doctors. You're right. That's the doctors. There are other options. They don't have to do that.
Yeah.
Right. And it's frustrating because, you know, everyone wants everything natural and organic, you know, when it comes to your food and your makeup and, you know, cleaning supplies in your house, everybody wants, you know, everything to be pure and natural, but we're gonna put these, you know, chemicals into our body to stop it from doing its natural processes because, you know, it's more convenient. It's just, it's silly.
Well, I hope you'll continue on with this issue. We haven't done it yet, but we're gonna put the names of our board members on our website. So if people wanna contact you and they're interested in working with you on this issue, you know, that would be
absolutely
great.
Yeah.
But we have to figure out a way to be more visible and to have more of an impact because, you know, now we're moving on to the next horrible issue, which is the LGBT, this giving, you know, allowing sex kids to decide whether or not they want to have a sex change without their parents' approval. And they can go to Planned Parenthood and other places and get, now I don't know about our local ones because I haven't seen anything, but I know it's happening around the country.
Yeah,
where they can stop the development with alternate hormones. And that's irreversible once it gets in. And, you know, everybody says they're concerned about children and child abuse. And this is...
How is this not the ultimate child abuse, you know?
Right.
What 7 or 8-year-old is mature enough to make a decision like that? I mean, it's it's unbelievable.
It's bad. So that's, we've had programs on there on our already, and we've had some articles, but the people who are promoting this are very strong, very organized, very well-funded. It's not going to be easy for all pro-life groups. And this is the Equality Act. This is what we're facing right now with this Equality Act, where they want us to think that all gender is okay. And it's terrible.
It's, you know.
I don't know if I mentioned this to you, but I mentioned it to some of my friends. I renewed my nurse's license. I'm a registered nurse. And I keep my license even though I haven't worked for 20 years. But I like to know what's going on and I like to keep it just in case. But this is my last year. But I just did it last week. When I had to fill out the application, I had to tell them what gender I identified with. And they gave me 5 choices.
It's laughable.
But at least they allowed me to say, I don't want to answer. And then the other one was sexual orientation. What was my sexual orientation? Heterosexual, homosexual, bisexual, prepared not to answer. What does that have to do? Right. Right. It's invasive of privacy. It's useless, but it shows how big this issue is becoming and how they want to control society and make everybody think. And the other thing in that Equality Act is they want to make everyone think the same, that abortion is a neutral moral issue. Now, you know, that's impossible. It's just impossible.
Yeah.
And you know, some things are not negotiable, and killing has always been a severe moral issue in our entire history of our country. So these attacks are getting, I think they're getting stronger and stronger, and it's really unfortunate.
I think the lines are being clearly drawn between good and evil, right and wrong. And eventually every single person is going to have to decide you know, what side are you on? It's not going to be ambiguous at all. There's just going to be very clear two choices. And, yeah. You know, if you just look at the general, you know, public this day, most people just want to get along and they're right. not going to stand up and they're, you know, they, you know, what percentage of our population used to identify as gay or lesbian? Very small,
very
but it's grown
small.
Tremendously because now it's the popular thing to do and everybody wants to fit in and nobody wants to stand out. And truth just kind of is not a thing anymore, you know?
Yeah. That's that you
objective
you
truth has just kind of vanished.
Yeah, and you have to you know, when everybody gets their information from the general news media, you know, they're getting tainted information. You know, we
right.
look
good you know, point.
Trump lost the election. We routinely drive from you know Wernersville to Pittsburgh, and we see nothing but Trump signs for the entire drive.
Yeah.
It's like this
even thing. Around here in the countryside, you know, not in the city, but everywhere else, there were tons of them.
Yeah, yeah, we're all like so, we all share yeah. the same beliefs, you know.
Yeah,
the most of the state is sharing the same beliefs yeah. we have, but we're being told that everybody wants to be equal and the cancer culture, you know, the cancel culture yeah. and so forth.
Now, you know, of course, we think all lives matter. We do not want to get into the whole hate. Thing, the whole prejudice thing, that's wrong. We know it. It's always been that way. And, but that's what they throw at us. If we try to say we disagree, oh, well then, you know, you've got a phobia against, you know, black skin or dark skin. And
yeah.
it's so cleverly disguised as propaganda and people just seem to buy it in. It's terrible.
And they're so good at taking up space. They're so good at overpowering you and shutting you down by calling you racist or sexist.
Right.
Or, you know, and you're just shut down. You know, you can't respond to those things because they don't allow a response.
Yeah. I grew up in Allentown, which is only an hour away. And I graduated from high school in the 60s. And we had African-American students. We had a few. We had some Hispanics. We had some Jewish people. I never knew there was a problem. I never once in my years in the high school, even in junior high, and I had an older brother and an older sister and a younger brother, never once did you ever hear of hate speech or Ku Klux Klan or any of that. The minority kids, such as the African-Americans, were fabulous athletes, and they were loved. We loved them, and they were absolutely a part of, you know, our class, and we were proud of them.
Mm-hmm.
So how this went from that to this whole hate business is...
Yeah.
It was very calculated. It was very calculated yeah. to yeah. divide the country intentionally, and...
Yeah.
People.
Well, yeah, I'm going to ask you another opinion because I want to pick your brain a little because you are willing to be active. You're going to be more active even than you are already. You're a wonderful example. So I want you to talk to our viewers about how they can become active. What are some of the, you know, maybe start with some of the easy things. What, like Paul, you got involved in the Republican Party, which,
yeah,
is that correct? I mean, that so what else would you suggest to people to get in with other like-minded people, I guess is what I'm trying to.
Yeah, I would say, you know, for starters, one of the other things that I did as a part of being in the Knights of Columbus and given my lecture that I was able
right,
to give,
right.
is I showed the trailer for Unplanned to my Knights of Columbus group and they were floored. You know, it's like eye opening.
Yeah.
You know, if you know, go watch that movie for starters, you know,
yeah.
go learn a little bit about, what we're trying to do. You know, it was a fabulous movie. I've probably seen it 3 or 4 times at least mm-hmm. now, you know, and yeah, there are some things that are hard to watch, but you know, it's reality, and babies mm-hmm. are dying, and you need to watch that, understand, and then decide what, you know, what you can do next.
Mm-hmm. And I think people have to understand that, the, you know, we don't want to be bashing Democrats, but the fact of the matter is their platform clearly supports abortion until the moment of birth. And that's what the equality bill is wants as well. Up to the, you know, the final stages of labor, you can rip that baby out and kill it. That would absolutely most likely live.
Yeah.
And how many Democrats that you know are willing to acknowledge that? It's tough, I think. I know very few. I mean, I know some that once their light bulb went on, they left the party. Thanks be to God. And you don't have to join the Republicans necessarily. You can become an independent, you know, we can't vote in the primary then, but you can at least pick your battles and state your issues. So that's a very good thing to get involved in. The and the Republican Party locally is just booming. I mean, there's a lot of activity that's going on. We had Clay Reese on, you know, last month, and
yes,
he's really on top of stuff and really fired up. And so I think there's a lot of future.
That's exciting to hear. When we heard him say that you know, that there was a big increase in interest and people running for the, you know, the small, the local positions. And that's great. You know, a lot of times, you know, we don't really know who we're voting for on the, you know, the school board mm-hmm. level or the, you know, the supervisor level. And, you know, that's definitely something that we need to get more involved in and you know exactly what we're voting for, because it all starts at the local level. And just mm-hmm. don't be afraid to have conversations. You know, sometimes I'll post something. I posted one article on Facebook or something, and my friend is like, you know, thank you for posting this, but I can't share it because I would get too much blowback, and you know, I can't share this on my Facebook. But you know,
well, don't some worry people about, can't if don't they're worry working, about the you know, they could lose their job, really.
True.
Depending on the company. If you're with a large company, they're not going to put up with it.
Right. Yeah. So, but don't be afraid to engage in those conversations.
Right.
And, you know, if it,
and
if
use
it
social media. That's a good point, too.
Yeah.
Get involved with the Republican Party if you can, if that suits your, you know, thought process. Stay away from the Democrats. Be vocal. Social media is limiting people, but it's still there.
It is.
So, and yeah, talk to the people around you.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah, I think we need to be tactical and decide where we can get the most bang for our buck, you know, and
right. Good point.
And work on our sales pitch and our communication to try to pull people in and get people on our side so we can,
yeah.
You know, close down some abortion clinics. I, you know, it was sometime, you know, this year we went down to pray at the new location mm-hmm. and I took my daughter, and it was a cold day. I mean, it was
it's been cold. Yeah.
You know, she's a 20-year-old and
uh-huh.
he didn't realize what she was in for, you know. I think we were going to be going shopping and come with uh-huh. us. And I think we went to church and then we went to the abortion clinic, and I'm like, come on out, we're going to pray. And she did not want to get out of the car. It was cold, mm-hmm. you know? And I said, you know, what if you praying this one rosary saved one baby?
Right. You know, that's it.
You know, that's all it. We're trying to do. That's
what it means being an activist. You never know how your prayers, your witness, you're just being there.
And you may never know. You may never feel
right.
that,
we,
you,
we know
that you've
that we
done
never.
Anything. But you may find out, you know,
yeah.
at Judgment Day, just exactly how you're acting.
Oh, yeah. Well, we've had people come back, you know, 1 or 2 years later and say, if you hadn't been here, I would have had an abortion. Now I have a 2-year-old. I mean, they,
wow.
That's great.
They, you know, that fabulous. That just makes it all worthwhile because
yep.
you know that had you not been here. And conversely, people who have had abortions, who had no support, say, if there had just been one person there that I could have talked to, I may not have gone through with it. Just one person. And so, you know, you never know. But that's wonderful. I hope she'll come out again.
Yeah, she might have to, you know, she's still young enough that we can force her.
Yeah.
You know, I
well, until she gets on her own. Yeah.
I got my baby picture up here behind us. So.
Oh, I'm blocking.
Oh, that's adorable.
That's adorable. That's the sign that we like to use when we.
And that's true. You're the voice for the voiceless, because who's gonna speak up for them if the mom is so wrapped up in her own head or on drugs, or, you know, the father doesn't want to give any money or any kind of support. You know, women get very desperate, and when you're desperate and scared, you don't make good decisions.
Very true.
So, so that's why we have those billboards up now. People can, when we're not there, they want to ask for help. They can go on the website. They can look at the resources, the pro-life resources in our region, not just Berks County, because a lot of the girls come from other areas, so their families don't find out, you know, that they're having an abortion. So you never quite know where they're coming from.
Yeah.
Right. Although there's a good many, you know, local.
And I do try to count the people waving and honking, and there's so much more positive.
Oh, absolutely. I haven't had at the new place. Yeah. I don't think I've had one negative since we've been there.
Yeah.
Which is amazing. And people that walk by every week going to work or something, starting to get to know them, and now they say hello. And
I think that's really,
one of us.
It's really important when you're standing there on the street corner to, you know, smile and show your
good
joy
point.
And greet the people that walk by, even if they're not going to say hello back or whatever. At least, you know, make an attempt to, you know, reach out and be, you know, human. And you know, the other side is always so angry and vile and you know yelling and vicious, you know, when they're
making us look like we're the enemy and we're the ones that want to provide the help, and yet, you know, they're good at painting the broad brush and making us all into terrorists.
Right.
Just you know, get on the list.
Yeah.
So what do you plan to work on in the future? Do you have any other issues that you haven't talked about yet that you're interested in?
You know, I think I'd like to get more people out praying the rosary. You know, I really would like, you know, that to be one of the things that we work on, is to get more people down there.
Yeah.
You know, and because once they do it one time, you know, then it can be like, hey, we did it once, you know, why don't we do it again?
Right.
You know, that was uncomfortable for us in the beginning.
Right. But I was petrified the very first time I went. I just followed what everybody else did.
Yeah.
But I didn't know, but
you know, we did that patriotic rosary, you know, with you a couple of years ago. And
that's a great rosary.
That was like mind blowing. It's like everybody should have a chance to experience doing the rosary like this. That was
just
incredible.
We gotta get Mary Alice Kuhns to come down again. She knows it by heart. She's a great leader for that rosary. I like it too, because there it's very specific what we're praying for. And we're praying for every state and every level of government. We're not leaving anybody out. And that's what we have. That's the way we have to think.
Yeah.
And it really helps. But we used to participate in some of the, you know, the sporadic events, you know, for coming out to pray. But, you know, a couple of years ago, it became very obvious. We need to be there every day, even though, you know, they're doing abortions twice a week, but they're also bringing the girls in for birth control, which can cause an abortion.
Sure.
It can be abortifacients.
Yeah.
So, and you know, we have girls coming in who may not be sure what they want to do. So we need people there, maybe not Sunday. I could say we could probably not worry about Sunday, but 6 days a week, we really ought to have people down there. And I know you two have been going regular. It's great. I go Tuesday and Friday morning, try to be there around 9 o'clock, pray the rosary with whoever comes. Sometimes I'll go on a Wednesday or Thursday just to see what's going on. But
and we try to go Saturdays after morning mass. So
that's nice.
Yeah, I'd say one of our goals would be that you know, that we almost like have the sign-up sheet. We have such a strong network of people like you and I that we can provide coverage.
Right. Well, now we need, we can do it. We didn't have a, we left our website go to pot. So now we can do that. We can start getting people to sign up.
Yeah.
We had some problems in the back, but.
And, you know, and also I would say.
See, our time is up. Do you know it's already 10:00? Wow, excellent. This went fast. Yeah. We have to close down because we have to get this in time for this to be able to be viewed by BCTV. But thank you so, so much for being on the program. And I know we're going to be hearing more from you. Feel free to write any articles if you want to send them on the newsletter.
Absolutely.
Any thoughts you have on like getting sign-up sheets for different days? We've tried different things and we still have to work on that. It's hard. But thank you so much.
Thanks
and
for having us.
We want to say good night, and we want to invite people to come to our next program in April, which is our guest is going to be Monica Miller, who is a feisty dynamo. You won't believe
great
what she's like. Oh my gosh.
All right.
So we're looking forward to that too. But thanks again and good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you, Kathy. Good night.
Pro Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.